Hello everyone, Dr. Ames here. Just a few quick comments to run over the contributions of the classical management perspective for you. Remember that the classical management perspective has two parts. They are both concerned about efficiency. Scientific management is the first part and is concerned about efficiency of the individual and that individual worker's performance. And administrative management, which is the second part, and is really concerned about the efficiency of the organization and how things are going overall and whether or not we're making the performance as a group that we should be. Okay, first, for the contributions of classical management. Well, certainly the first one is it established management as a profession. This is the first real theory of management. And so it therefore is the foundation that everything we have developed since has relied on and actually synthesized from. Remember also that the theory itself was percolating around, and it doesn't belong to any one particular person, although Frederick Taylor is called the father of modern management and is part of the scientific management perspective of this theory. He certainly did invent this. This was in the minds of many theorists in the UK, in Europe, and the United States. Okay, so that was the first one, established management as a profession. The second one is that this theory laid the foundations for further developments in management theory. And it certainly does. We've talked about some of the administrative management theorists, for example, who really their careers were entirely based on thinking and the publications and work of Henry Fayol. And so certainly those are the two big contributions of the classical management perspective. Now, when it comes to the downside, and there are always downsides to each one of these perspectives that we'll work through, the limitations of classical management include, first, that it is mainly suitable for a very stable and a simple organizational environment. In other words, what we're talking about here is something that's predictable. So if you're in a sort of an industry or a factory where the same thing is done over and over, there's very little change, if any, ever. There are no big changes in technology or machinery or methods that haven't already been thought of and implemented. That's a stable and simple environment. Now, a good example of a simple and stable environment in today's modern workplace would be the fast food industry. A fast food industry job means you learn a certain set of skills. You repeat them over and over. They've all been figured out, right? They get an orientation that tells them how to do that specific job. And generally what you see is not a lot of real necessarily teamwork where if someone's behind, someone will run over and help them do their job. That doesn't happen. If you're the cook, you're cooking. If you're the cleanup person over here, you're cleaning up. If you're working the drinks in the drive-thru window, that's what you do. You don't go back and help the burger person and so forth. And some people are set for the customer service and the manager flutters around and manages the routine. So that is today's simple and stable environment. Although it's busy, but it's still pretty simple. It's easy to figure out what's going on, and it's very predictable in that sense. So it is driven very much by scientific method. And that is exactly what this theory is all about, doing things efficiently. And think about it. People are waiting at the counter, and people are waiting in line in their cars, and they're in a hurry. And they want everything as quick as possible. So in order to do that, it's got to be a fairly predictable environment where you can work towards the highest amount of efficiency and performance. The difference is you don't have to lose sight that people are people. And we'll talk about that conversation as we move through the rest of the theories. The second limitation of classical management is the fact that it believed it was the one best way to do thing, and we could probably never ever come up with a better idea of how to organize and lead and make decisions and control things. So this is what's known as a belief in universal procedures, and this is certainly a limitation. We don't believe in that at all today in business. We believe in any idea that works and is moral and ethical and fair. It's ours for the using. We don't believe that there's one answer necessarily that solves all our problems, that does everything for us. So the belief in universal procedures was a limitation, and it did limit thinking. The third and final limitation here, I'd like you to remember, is that it really comes right out of a negative view of the individual worker, who many assumed didn't want to work unless you paid them a lot of money, or money period, and that they had to have that close supervision. Well, in that sense, the limitation was employees were viewed as replaceable tools. Well, we've done all the work for you, really. We've planned your job out and made it very easy. All you have to do is come to work and do what we've set out for you. And if you can't handle it, or if you don't, you know, you fall behind, your production's not good, we'll find somebody else. It's easy to find another worker that can be trained to do your job. You are a replaceable tool. Okay, folks, that's the contributions and limitations of the classical management perspective. I'll talk to you soon.